Penguin Random House Audio presents The Drifter by Nicholas Petrie. Read for you by Stephen Mendel. Prologue. The Man in the Black Canvas Chore Coat. He walked into Harder's Grange, announced by a chrome-plated bell mounted to the door jamb. The faded black barn coat made him look bulky. It was mostly the coat. He wore a John Deere hat pulled down low, but there were no cameras. It was a farm supply store in the middle of nowhere, like they all were. He saw a chipped formica service counter, a pot of overcooked coffee, and a few chairs for waiting customers and old-timers looking for company. He understood that most of these places served as a kind of social center for local farmers whose lives were pretty solitary. He'd grown up on a farm himself, although not in this state. Behind the counter was a weather-beaten 60-something guy in a red plaid dress shirt. He looked up at his only customer, then tucked the USDA brochure he was using as a bookmark into his paperback vampire novel. The man in the coat set a pleasant expression on his face. "Morning," he said. "It definitely is," said the counterman, a wide, cheerful smile stretching his wrinkles into a new topography. "And not a bad one at that. What can I do you for?" "My mom just bought some property this side of Monroe," said the man in the coat, "off Highway 11, and she needs some fertilizer for her garden." "Son, you come to the right place. We got all kinds. What do you need?" "I've been trying to get her to use manure, but she says she can't stand the smell. She's looking to plant a half acre." The counterman whistled. "A half acre? That's some garden." "Well, she and my dad had 600 acres of soybeans and corn in Bureau County, Illinois, so a half acre isn't much to her." He shrugged. "She likes to keep busy since my dad died." The counterman nodded in sympathy. "Anyway, with the farm, she was using Prairie King, the 6400. I believe 2 sacks would cover a half acre, right?" The counterman looked at him. He was on the far side of 60, but his brown eyes were clear and focused. This was always the moment, thought the man in the coat. He'd told a good story. He looked right. He sounded right. But farming and the farm supply business was local, and the counterman didn't know his face, which counted for a lot, especially since 1995, and again since 2001. Finally, the counterman spoke. "Son, that's ammonium nitrate," he said. "I can't sell to just anyone, even if it is only 100 pounds. We got rules about that kind of stuff. You got your yellow card?" "Oh, yeah," said the man in the coat, putting a sheepish look on his face. "Hang on, I got it right here." He pulled out his wallet, a worn-down ballistic nylon item with a camouflage pattern. Even the wallet had been carefully assembled to make a certain impression. He pulled out a driver's license and a laminated yellow ID showing that he was registered with the state to buy certain kinds of fertilizers and pesticides. The form was a single page. The application fee was $44. The counterfeit driver's license had cost a lot more than that. The counterman scrutinized both cards, looking from one to the other and back again. "Looks good," he said. "Nothing personal, and you're only getting 100 pounds, I know. But the state's dead serious about it." He pushed the cards across the counter to the man in the coat, then flashed a grin. "Wouldn't want any of them goddamn socialists to get hold of this stuff." The man in the coat smiled. "No, sir," he said. "We surely wouldn't." The counterman pecked the order into an antique computer and took payment in cash. He directed his customer around to the loading dock to pick up his fertilizer. 10 minutes later, the man in the black canvas chore coat turned the old blue Ford pickup onto the county highway, headed northeast. It was his second stop that day. 3 more before nightfall. Right on schedule. Part 1. Chapter 1. There was a pit bull under the front porch, and it didn't want to come out. Young Charlie Johnson said,
"That dang dog's been there for weeks, sir. It already ate up all the cats and dogs around here. I can't even let my dang little brother out the front door no more."
The 100-year-old house sat on a narrow lot on the edge of a battered Milwaukee neighborhood that, like the house, had seen better days. It was early November, not warm, not even by Wisconsin standards. The leaves had already fallen from the skeletal trees that towered overhead. But the sun was out, which counted for something, and the sky was a high, pale morning blue. Not a morning for static, not at all. Peter Ash said, "Just how big is this dog?" Charlie shook his head. "Never seen it up close, sir, and never in daylight, but it's awfully dang big, I can tell you that." "Didn't you call animal control?" "Oh, my mama called," said Charlie. "Two men came, took one look under there, got right back in their truck and drove away." Charlie wore a school uniform, a light blue permanent press dress shirt, dark blue polyester dress pants, and giant polished black shoes on his oversized feet. He was the kind of skinny, big-eared 12-year-old kid who could eat 6 meals a day and still be hungry. But his eyes were older than his years. They didn't miss a thing. He was watching Peter Ash now. Peter sat on the closed lid of a wooden toolbox, his wide, knuckly hands on the work-worn knees of his carpenter's jeans, peering through the narrow access hatch cut into the rotted pine slats enclosing the space under the porch. He had to admit the dog sounded big. He could hear it growling back there in the darkness, like a tank engine on idle, only louder. He had a .45 under the seat of his pickup, but he didn't want to use it. It wasn't the dog's fault, not really. It was hungry and scared and alone, and all it had was its teeth. On the other hand, Peter had told Charlie's mother, Dinah, that he would fix the rotting supports beneath her ancient porch. She hadn't mentioned the dog. Peter really couldn't blame her. Her husband had killed himself, and it was Peter's fault. Peter was lean and rangy, muscle and bone, nothing extra. His long face was angular, the tips of his ears slightly pointed, his dark hair the unruly shag of a buzz cut grown wild. He had the thoughtful eyes of a werewolf a week before the change. Some part of him was always in motion. Even now, sitting on that toolbox, peering under that porch, his knee bobbed in time to some interior metronome that never ceased. He'd fought 2 wars over 8 years, with more deployments than he cared to remember. The tip of the spear. He'd be 31 in January. As he bent to look through the narrow access hatch under the porch, he could feel the white static fizz and pop at the base of his skull. That was his name for the fine-grained sensation he lived with now, the white static. A vague crackling unease, a dissonant noise at the edge of hearing. It wasn't quite uncomfortable, not yet. The static was just reminding him that it didn't want him to go inside. Peter knew it would get worse before he was done, so he might as well get to it. The space under the porch was about 3 feet high, maybe 12 feet wide and 12 deep with a dirt floor, about the size of 4 freshly dug graves laid sideways. The smell was rank, worse than a sergeant's feet after 2 months in a combat outpost, but not as bad as a 2-week-old corpse. Light trickled in through the slatted sides of the porch, but shadows shrouded the far corner, some kind of cast-off crap back there, and that growl he could just about feel through the soles of his boots. It would be good to do this without being chewed on too much. He went out to his truck and found a cordless trouble light, some good rope, and a length of old handrail. White oak, 1¾ inches thick, maybe 18 inches long. Nice and solid in the hand, which was a help when you were contemplating something spectacularly stupid. Serenaded by the growls from the crawl space, he sat down on the toolbox and took out his knife while young Charlie Johnson watched. Not that Peter wanted an audience, this certainly could get ugly. "Don't you have some place to go, Charlie? School or something?" Charlie glanced at a cheap black digital watch strapped to his skinny wrist. "No, sir," he said. "Not yet, I don't." Peter just shook his head. He didn't like it, but he understood. He figured he wasn't that far from 12 years old himself. He cut 3 short lengths from his rope and left the remainder long, 10 or 12 feet. Tied one end of a short piece of rope tight to each end of the oak rail. Looped the last short rope and the remainder through his belt a single time so he could get at it quickly. Then he looked up at Charlie again. You better get out of here, kid. If this goes bad, you don't want to be around. Charlie said,
I'm not a dang kid, sir. I'm the man of the family.
He reached inside the door, brought out an aluminum baseball bat, and demonstrated his.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.